Hey, brothers and sisters. This is your most radical, favorite, extreme brother from another mother. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise the living God. Hallelujah. God is good all the time. He put a song of praise in this heart of mine. God is good. God is good all the time. Hallelujah, brothers and sisters. Praise God. About to head out to the Philippines and be on the road the next week after tomorrow. And I want to come make a video and give you a little word that the Lord has had me in my spirit all day. And it comes from Ephesians chapter 3. Let's start at verse 16. That he would grant you, this is the Apostle Paul speaking, that he would grant you according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with might by his spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that ye being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and the length and the depth and the height, and to know the love of Christ which passeth knowledge, that ye may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now unto him that is able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all we can ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us, unto him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout ages, world without end. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. Anyway, so today I talked to lots of people, but two different sisters. And both of those different sisters, the Lord was leading me in this from the same text. And one of them was a sister about going to heaven and pets being in heaven, and that she had a pet that died and wanted to know if the pet would be in heaven. We talked about it. Of course, we talked about that before. I believe that when we get to heaven and we have our dwelling place, our mansion, our dwelling place, when we have our area in heaven, whatever it is that brings pleasure to you, that's a wholesome thing, God's going to let you have it. If you like to have ride horses, the Lord will let you have horses. If you have a pet, the Lord will give you the pet. Because what you love, the Lord loves. You know, of course, things that are wholesome, things that are good, things that are lovely, as Paul said, you know. Like the Lord is altogether lovely. You are altogether lovely, altogether worthy. Hallelujah, Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. He is altogether lovely and altogether worthy. Hallelujah. Praise God. And then the other sister has dyslexia. And she was having trouble reading the King James. And so we talked about it, and she studied lots of different translations. And she's reading this easy-to-read version. I guess it's ERV. And she recommends that to people if you have dyslexia. And I told her, yeah, I mean, I believe that people should read the King James, but of course, if you have a reason that you can't, of course, read what you can read. Absolutely. And I even told her that, you know, as you read, God would increase your ability. That, you know, I'm believing that the Lord will heal you of dyslexia while you're reading the Bible. And the Lord would expand your, the Lord would make your eyes a straight path from your eyes and your ears to your brain, to your mind, that you can get a full understanding and be able to read the King James after a season of reading this ERV version of the Bible. And so when we were praying, the Lord gave me a word from the same text, which is about verse 18, which is that you may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and the length and the depth of the height, and to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. So the Lord gave me this text for her, and then, of course, it means lots of things, but for her, is that she may be able to comprehend, you know, the breadth and the length and the depth and the height of, you know, of the wisdom of the Word of God. Hallelujah. It can also mean, of course, that we would know the love of God. And by the way, Paul has given us, for all you scientifically minded people, you talk to any atheists and stuff, the Bible is the oldest known text to introduce hyperdimensionalism instead of just length, width, and height, which is the third dimension that we live in. It also gives another dimension that is beyond, of course, we know the fourth dimension is time. It gives even another dimension. So God knew, of course, because God created everything, and even we see wisdom like that hidden in the Bible, that if we would be, you know, people who are scientists who are also Christians, you go through there and you would start seeing things that shows that, you know, the Bible is a whole lot more advanced than what the devil's people would try to say, atheists would try to attack the Word of God. But anyway, brothers and sisters, I wanted to praise the Lord with you. I wanted to worship the Lord with you. I wanted you to experience, to go with me for this text. This purpose of the text is in my spirit today for you. Besides the two things, for those two individuals, for the sister's pet died, the part about, you know, that God is, the Lord is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all we can ask or think. So, for you guys, right now, that you would be filled with the fullness. Listen to this. That he may grant you, that he would grant you. Paul was praying that God would grant the church, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with the might by his spirit in the inner man, in your spirit man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith. Okay, you'd be born again, and then Christ dwell in you, and you'd be steadfast in Christ, not depart from the faith. That you may be rooted and grounded in love. That you know that you should be rooted and grounded in love. It's all about, you know, the commandments of the New Testament. To love God with all your heart, all your mind, and all your soul. To love your neighbor as yourself. To do unto others as you would have them do unto you. Love one another as I have loved you. You know, the disciples. People know you're my disciples because you have love for one for another. The Apostle John told us in 1 John that, you know, you pass from death to life because you have love for the brethren. And the Bible says, if you can't, and I believe it's also 1 John. He says, if you can't love your brother whom you've seen, you know, how is it you say you love the Lord whom you have not seen, and you can't love the brother whom you've seen? And you're talking about brethren. We're talking about brothers and sisters in Christ, not our natural brothers and sisters. That's a whole other thing. If they're enemies of the cross, they're, you know, we're supposed to be enemies of the world. We're at enmity. Just like, you know, there's enmity between Satan and humans, and sin and humans. Let me say that too, as I was thinking about that today, as the Lord would have me say that. You know, they use that expression, you know, the world, the devil's people, they come up with all kinds of stuff like pro-choice, meaning they don't say, you know, pro-baby killer, infanticide. You know, they say pro-choice instead of pro-life. So it's like, if you don't believe in killing unborn babies, then you're anti-choice. Well, another term they use is homophobia. Homophobic, that's what they label. Oh, you're a Nazi, homophobic, whatever. So homophobic, God gave us a natural enmity to all sin. And then as we're children, we have that. And then later on, you know, we build up immunity to what God, the natural God-given aversion, enmity toward the work of the devil. Of any kind of sin, but particularly in this case, we're talking about things that are listed in the Bible as abominations, which is man lying with men, as an example, is a particular, specific abomination that the Lord calls out, even though all sin is sin. But brothers and sisters, it is a God-given, built-in program from God. God has programmed us to have an aversion to all sin, but particularly things that are an abomination to God. So that's why people, the Bible says to flee from sin. So that's why people flee from homosexuality. But you know, brothers and sisters, as a mature Christian, like myself as a pastor, you know, there are many people who watch my channel who are homosexuals who are trying to stop. And we are in contact. We talk. I pray with them. I talk to them and pastor them. But the difference of the church in America today and in Europe and all that, they're telling people that it's not a sin. That even Jesus, I have heard them even say, I don't even know why I'm talking about this, said that, you know, John, the Apostle John, laid his head on the Lord's breast at the Last Supper. So, you know, they were probably gay. These are the things that people who are involved in homosexuality will go, the lengths they'll go to justify their sin. And that many people in the church are justifying sin. So brothers and sisters, it's not we condemn people, we condemn sin. And all people are condemned by God unless they become born again. As the Lord Jesus told us in one passage in particular, that's one to recall, is John chapter 3. Jesus said those, you know, who believe in him, you know, receive eternal life. But those who do not believe in him, the wrath of God remains on them, or abides on them, as the King James says. The wrath of God remains on those who are not born again, who have not believed in Jesus Christ. So that goes for all people. So they are condemned until they get saved because of they're born in sin, not particularly for something they're doing, but they have sin in their life. Of course they've sinned. So whatever their sin is, it could be homosexuality, it could be whatever. But the point is, until they're born again and they repent of their sins and they're forgiven of their sins, the wrath of God remains on them. That's right out of the mouth of the Lord Jesus Christ, John chapter 3. So brothers and sisters, as they say, you know, you love the sinner and you hate the sin. So, and we have an aversion. If you are walking in the way God made you, you have a conscience. We all have a conscience. Even non-believers, they have a conscience. And the Bible talks about people having their conscience seared with a hot iron. Their conscience becomes seared with a hot iron, and they become, callous, hard-hearted, callous. And someone could actually go over to what the Bible calls a reprobate mind, to where they couldn't be saved if they wanted to. They're so lost and so blind in such darkness the Lord has turned them over to Satan. And they're gone, brothers and sisters. They're gone. Unless, you know, someone were to intervene or whatever, some miracle from God, you know, major miracle from God. But they're a reprobate mind, brothers and sisters. They're gone over. But praise God, that's few and far in between. Praise God. Almost everybody that I've ever met, I've only met one or two people that I said, well, you know, I suspect this person is reprobate. I didn't even know that because, you know, unless the Lord told you. I suspected they were reprobate. But there are tons of people. I don't care what you've been doing. I'll just be more a first person here. I don't care what you've been doing, brothers and sisters. I don't care if you've been in homosexuality. I don't care if you know what. I don't care if you've been doing intravenous heroin or whatever you've been doing. The grace of God is sufficient for thee. The length and the width and the height and the depth of his love is good enough for you. Hallelujah. Praise God. God has going to make a way for you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's his amazing love. You know, amazing love, how can it be that you, my king, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true. Yes. And it's my joy to honor you. In all I do, I honor you. Lord, in all I do, I honor you. Christians, for Christians now. And all you do, are you honoring him? Hallelujah. You know, every time you do something, is this in honor of God? Does this bring honor to God or disgrace, you know? Is this bring a bad witness to the name of Christ or a good name? Hallelujah. Anything you're doing, any sin that you might be doing, you know, or show it, especially anytime, but particularly in public, you know, as an example. You know, you're out here, and of course it's a sin to get drunk if you're a Christian. Now, the Bible says, you know, a little wine is good for the stomach. As I've talked about this many times, but there are most people don't drink a little wine. It's good for their stomach. They drink to get drunk, to get a buzz. That is a sin. Okay. So if you drink and get drunk, that's a sin. And then when you go out in public and you're supposed to be a Christian, people say, oh, I know so-and-so, he's a Christian, and they saw you at church or whatever, and they're not a Christian, particularly if they're not a Christian, and then they see you drunk. They say, oh, well, you know, he's supposed to be, what a hypocrite. All those Christians are a bunch of hypocrites. See, that's another sin. That's another sin to cause people to stumble, to get in the way of, you know, of someone getting saved. That's even worse. That's much worse, brothers and sisters. Hallelujah. So we're all guilty of all these things, brothers and sisters. Whatever, you could sit here, I could sit here and name 100 different things, and, you know, you're guilty of some, I'm guilty of some, whatever they may be, brothers and sisters. But hallelujah. The good news is, hallelujah, that if we sin, we have an advocate with the Father, even the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. John chapter 1, verse 7, 8, 9. Along in there, it says that we have an advocate with the Father. You know, and if we confess our sins, he is just and faithful to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. Cleanse us of all unrighteousness. Hallelujah. Cleanse us of all unrighteousness. All unrighteousness. To cleanse us. Of all unrighteousness, to cleanse us of all unrighteousness, to cleanse us of all unrighteousness. Brothers and sisters, think about it. The Lord would cleanse us of all our unrighteousness if we confess our sins, to repent, to call upon his name. Lord, I did such and such today, Lord. I know I shouldn't have done it. And I got mad and I yelled at my husband or wife, or, you know, I had unforgiveness today towards someone, et cetera, et cetera. Lord, I forgive them in Jesus' name, and forgive me, Lord, for not forgiving them, you know, for hope, you know, having anger all day about something, whatever it is. Whatever it is, Lord, brothers and sisters, from the smallest to the greatest sin, people have killed people and ended up being preachers. You know, and then there's people that, you know, try to condemn them. You know, the Bible says there is now, therefore, no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who walk according to the Spirit and not according to the flesh. Romans chapter 8, verse 1. The whole chapter talks about walking according to the Spirit and not according to the deeds of the law is what it's talking about. Hallelujah. For a righteousness is by faith, as we just read in that text. It's we abide in Christ by faith. Hallelujah. It's a righteousness that cometh by faith. Hallelujah. Praise God. Have you got faith in the Lord today? Hallelujah. Do you have faith in the living God? Have you put your faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, who shed his blood on Calvary's cruel cross, that you might be free? Hallelujah. Praise God that we might be free. Hallelujah. I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well, and your Spirit lives within me. Because you died and rose again. Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true, and it's my joy to honor you in all I do. I honor you, Lord, in all I do. I honor you. Hallelujah. Think about it. I'm accepted. He was condemned. Hallelujah. You think about that. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Have you been thanking the Lord for that? Have you been calling upon him and praising him for that? I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well. Your spirit lives within me because you died and rose again. That's what the Lord did for us. He came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. Hallelujah. You know, he did all that. That's the gospel right there in a little song. Lord, I lift your name on high. Hallelujah. Let's bless his name right now, brothers and sisters. You got to praise him. It's what the Lord has done. Hallelujah. Look what the Lord has done. He's healed my body. He touched my mind. He saved me just in time. I'm going to praise his name. Each day is just the same. I'm going to praise him. Look what the Lord has done. Hallelujah. Look what the Lord has done. Let's bless him. Let's bless him, brothers and sisters. Let's keep blessing the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I've got so much to thank you for, oh, so much. Sing to him. To praise you for you see, he's been so good to me. And when I reach sweet heaven's doors and there, just let me kneel once more. I've got so much to thank him for. Bless him, bless him. I've got so much to thank him for, oh, so much to praise him for you see. He's been so good to me, and when I reach sweet heaven's doors and there, just let me kneel once more. I've got so much to thank him for. Hallelujah. The song is so much to thank him for, but I try to remember to say so much to thank you for. Sing it to the Lord, not about the Lord, but to the Lord. Hallelujah. Every time I hear a song, I want to change it to the Lord, not about the Lord. Hallelujah. I've got so much to thank you for, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. The Bible says to enter his gates with thanksgiving in your heart. You will enter his courts with praise. I will say this is the day that the Lord hath made. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. He has made me glad, you have made me glad. I will rejoice for you have made me glad. Now that particular song is from the Psalms. So in the Bible it says he has made me glad. You know, so that's why I would say it that way usually. But those songs that's been written by a person, I would change it. That's just what I do, brothers and sisters. Don't worry about it. If the Lord's not leading you to do it, this is what I do. Hallelujah, because I want to talk to the Lord. That's praying. It's talking to the Lord. Praising is talking about the Lord. You know, and worship is talking to the Lord. Hallelujah. If I say, look what the Lord has done. Hallelujah. That's praising him, you know. I just want to praise you. Lift my hands and say, I love you. You are everything to me. And I exalt your holy name on high. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, we exalt your holy name, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord. Come see his glory. Come see his beauty. Come see his love. Hallelujah, Lord. Lord, we bless your holy name. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Yes, Lord, you are good, Lord. So good. God, you're so good. You're so good to me. Hallelujah. We bless you, Lord. Hallelujah. Do you worship the Lord? We bless him, praise him, worship him. Hallelujah. I worship you. This is Chloe in Australia. I just posted a video the other day. Brother Terry had sent me a video of his daughter. I posted this, a little clip of it. He gave me permission to do that of Sister Chloe, who's 3 years old there in the land down under in Australia. This is the song that she was singing on the video. I worship you, Almighty God. There is none like you. We worship you, O Prince of Peace. That is what I long to do, and I give you praise. For you are my righteousness. Hallelujah, Lord. We worship you, O King of Kings. That is what we long to do, and we give you praise. For you are our righteousness. Hallelujah, Lord. We bless you, Lord. Hallelujah. We bless you, Lord God, for you are good all the time. Hallelujah. You know, if you sing to the Lord from your heart, from your spirit man, and the Bible calls it your heart, from your inner man, as that text said, the text that I read says the inner man, our spirit man, our heart, when you worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. That's from John chapter 4, where the Lord said, you know, God is not in Samaria, or he's not in Jerusalem, but the time is coming and now is when God wishes those to worship him. That God is a spirit, and he wishes those to worship him in spirit and in truth. So we worship him in spirit and in truth. Hallelujah. You got to worship him and love him. You know, you go to churches and they say, oh, you want to sing? Are you a good singer? You know, performance. Brothers and sisters, it's not a performance for anybody but God. Hallelujah. You know, just like I've said the other day, you know, if your kid is in the school play, they could be the worst singer in the whole crowd, right? People can mock them. I've had people that mock me in my singing in the video. But my Father, which art in heaven, when he hears me singing, you know, it's like when your kid is in the school play, you know, you go make a videotape. You know, it's like, I want everybody to be quiet because that's my kid. Your kid may sound like fingernails on a chalkboard. They may sound like an angel, but that's your kid. You want to get a videotape of your kid and pictures and say, oh, yeah, here's my kid. You know, here we're going to, you know, proud of your kid. Hallelujah. Well, my Father's proud of me. And, you know, and as an example, someone's picking on you, but, you know, I'm not worried about it, but someone's picking on you. Remember that who your Father is. Hallelujah. You know, God is your Father. You know, they picked the wrong kid to mess with. You know what I'm saying? It's like your dad is like, you know, like the President Trump's kid, you know, like Baron Trump. Somebody's going to try to bully him and pick on him and punch him. Well, they picked the wrong kid. I mean, the guy's got Secret Service agents with him, you know. So when Baron Trump goes out, he's got Secret Service agents, and his dad is the President of the United States. So how much more me and you, if you're a child of the Most High God, the Creator of heaven and earth, you know, El Elyon, which is Hebrew for the Most High God. I mean, imagine if someone's trying to bully you, trying to mess with you, or whatever they might try to do. I mean, they've messed with the wrong person. Hallelujah, because I'm a child of God. Hallelujah, you're messing with the God of creation. I mean, you're making a mistake. When God said, you know, about Israel, you know, those who touch me have touched Israel, have touched the apple of my eye. Well, brothers and sisters, we're adopted children of Abraham. Hallelujah. You know, Abraham is the father of Isaac, who was the father of Jacob, whose name was changed to Israel. So when they say the children of Israel, they're talking about the physical children of Israel. Well, Israel's daddy was Isaac, and his father was Abraham. We are adopted children of Abraham by faith in Jesus Christ. So we are also God's chosen people. We're the spiritual children of God, the spiritual seed, the church. Israel is the natural seed. I'm going to another teaching. Well, the Bible clearly lays this out. You know, there's the first Adam, the Bible says, and then Jesus is the second Adam. It says first the natural, then the spiritual. So first you had the natural Adam, and then you had the spiritual Adam, which is the Lord Jesus Christ. And then you had the natural seed of Abraham, which is the nation of Israel. Then you have the spiritual seed of Abraham, which is the church. Brothers and sisters, that's us. That's what the Bible says. Hallelujah. Praise God. We are the children of God, spiritual children of God. Hallelujah. We're the adopted sons of God. Hallelujah. You know, it says we're seated with Christ far above all gods. Hallelujah. We're seated far above all powers and principalities. I'm talking about gods. I'm talking about little g. I'm talking about fallen angels and demons and rulers of this creation. You know, even president of the United States, the president of Philippines or whatever you want to talk about. We're seated far above them, far above those powers and principalities, those demons and fallen angels and even the holy angels, we're seated far above them. It says we're sitting on the throne with Christ. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's what the Bible says. You got to get that down in your spirit, man, brothers and sisters. We're seated with Christ in heavenly places already. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We're children of God. A lot of people, they just can't get that, because if they believed that, if people really believed, you know, the Lord has had me teach out of this text. The text that we're talking about. I've been singing and stuff, worship God, because I want you to get the spiritual anointing of the fullness of God. But what does it say? That God may grant you. I pray that God would grant you according to the riches of his glory. So we need the glory of God upon us. The riches of his glory, the fullness of his glory to come down on us. Let the glory fall. That's revival. To be strengthened with might by his spirit in the inner man. Not to be strengthened with just words or strengthened with oatmeal or, Red Bull, but to be strengthened with the might by his spirit, by the spirit of God in your inner man. That's the problem with these religious people. There's a lot of religious people that watch my videos. They're not spirit-filled people. You know, they got the power of the word right here, but they didn't wash it down into their spirit man with the Holy Spirit. This is what it says, that he may grant you according to the riches of his glory. I could preach all day just on this one verse, brothers and sisters, by the spirit of God. The riches of his glory to be strengthened with might by spirit in the inner man, in your spirit, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that you may be rooted and grounded in love. It didn't say to be rooted and grounded in head knowledge, but in love. Love is emotion. Love is from the heart. It's not up here, but love is here, brothers and sisters. Hallelujah. Didn't you ever know that song by the Monkees? You know, now I'm a believer. I once thought love was only in fairy tales, for others, but not for me. But then, I can't remember all the words of the song by the Monkees, but, then I met you and then I fell in love. Now I'm a believer. Then I saw her face. Now I'm a believer. You know, he thought love, a lot of people are like that. They think love is only in fairy tales. A lot, especially men, they think love is not real. But when they get struck by love, you're talking about, true love of meeting, you're somebody you're going to marry. You have that strike of true love. Then you say, wow, it's really real. You know, people acting all goofy and stupid. It's of love. So our love for God is even higher than that, brothers and sisters. It's an emotional thing. It's in the heart. It's of the heart, brothers and sisters. All these people like a Joel John MacArthur, he wouldn't know the Holy Spirit. He doesn't know the Lord. Because he's, you don't rely on experiences. You rely just on the word. No, it's the word and experiences that line up with the word. Getting born again is an experience, brothers and sisters. If you didn't have an encounter with the Spirit of the living God, if you didn't say, Jesus called me to come down front and be prayed for. You're not in tears and just heartbroken that, and humbled and just broken that Jesus saved me. Then you didn't get saved, brothers and sisters. The church is full of false converts. People's got a mental assent, a mental agreement that the words of God is true. But brothers and sisters, when the Spirit of God gets a hold of you, it's a whole new thing, brothers and sisters. You become a believer. You thought that it's all words, but it's not words, brothers and sisters, on a page. But it's to be quickened by the Spirit of God, brothers and sisters. That's what this text is saying. This is just one of many texts that we're touching on here. Listen to this. You be rooted and grounded in love. I could preach all day on one predicate, whatever you call it, each section of each sentence. I forgot the grammatical term for it, whatever. Verse 18, may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth and the length and the depth and the height, and to know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge. Just see, that's what I was just saying. See, until God quickens my mind, myself. I didn't even think about, like I said, I could preach all day. I mean, the Lord is just, boom, by his spirit enlightening this to me. Listen to this. To know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge. So you can have head knowledge of the word, but the love of Christ just passes that. But that's what I'm trying to say. Thank you, Lord. I'm preaching before I even got to you know, to really stare at the verse here and really get it in my eyes here and see what it's saying. That you might be filled with all the fullness of God. That's what I'm trying to do. That you would be filled with it. That's revival, is to be filled with the fullness of God. To know the depth and length and height and all those things of God, however you want to say it. Now, unto him that is able to exceedingly and abundantly of all we can ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us. What's the power of the Holy Spirit? It's not your intellect. Just like people talk about, oh, what gifts of the Spirit? Yeah, these old religious denominational people. Oh, I have the gift of a discernment. They always say that. It's a supernatural gift. They'll hear somebody speaking in tongues and say, well, that's not a language. Well, do you know every language in the world? Number one, you don't know every language in the world. Number two, it's supernaturally to be interpreted. It's supernaturally to be spoken and supernaturally to be interpreted. If you were a native German speaker, or you could speak German, and then I started speaking in tongues in German, and you understood it because you already know German, that's not supernatural, nothing about that. You already knew how to speak German, even though God could have meant it for you because you're not saved or whatever. That's true too. But the gift of interpretation of tongues is for someone to understand it, and they don't know the language, brothers and sisters. Just like when you speak in tongues, it's an unknown tongue to you. It's an unknown tongue to you, but somebody knows it. Whether it be by heaven or earth, as the Bible says, though I speak with tongues of men or angels. And angels, he says. Paul said, though I speak with the tongues of men and angels, but without love I am nothing. There we go back to love. Oh, the Lord's got me on love. That's the theme of this video. See, I don't even know the theme of, the Lord had me on this text all day, and I didn't even know the theme of this video is going to be about love. His love. Hallelujah. I don't know it until I make the video, brothers and sisters. Believe it or not. Maybe you do believe it. Hallelujah. If you know, I go with the flow of the Spirit of God, brothers and sisters, and that's where the power is. That's where revival is. Hallelujah. You got to be led by the Spirit. You imagine when the Spirit of the Lord came on Jesus, it said, well, after he was baptized, it says the Spirit of the Lord ascended on him, and he was led by the Spirit into the wilderness. Well, how does the Spirit lead you? Where does the Spirit of God go? In your heart, brothers and sisters, in your heart. You're led by your heart. Some people say, oh, don't let your emotions lead you. Well, yeah, you know, you have to have temperance about anger, emotions in the flesh, like anger and wrath and maybe, you know, lust. People, a lot of people get lust and love confused. You know, you have a desire to fornicate with someone, to have sex with someone you're not married to, that it can is lust probably more than anything, than love. So there's all those natural emotions, but then there's the fruit of the Spirit, brothers and sisters. And love is one of those, the agape love of God. Hallelujah, to be led by the Spirit. Why do we let the Lord lead us by his Spirit? Because we love him. Jesus said, if you love me, you'll do the things I say. Oh, it's just so simple, brothers and sisters. I don't care what anybody thinks or whatever, but I'm saying right now, this has got to be the greatest video I've ever made. Even though if you don't have an ear to hear it, it might not seem like it. People think the greatest video I ever made was a dream I had about maybe when the rapture might be. That's not the greatest dream, and that is nothing. The day the rapture happens, it's over. Whatever day the rapture is, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. There's no rewards and crowns and special Cracker Jack surprises because you know what day the rapture is, brothers and sisters. That means nothing. The rapture is just an event where we go to be with Christ, and what matters is what you've done in this life until that point, brothers and sisters. For eternity, you will live with the rewards you lost and the rewards you received, that the things you've done in the name of Christ. As Jesus said, you give a cup of cold water to a prophet in my name, you will not lose a prophet. You know, you'll receive a prophet's reward. Brothers and sisters, I mean, this is the things that count. Did you ever not read in the Word about the parable of the wise virgins and the foolish virgins? Five had oil and five didn't. Did you not read in the same Word, same chapter, Matthew chapter 25, where the Lord tells the parable of the talents, that he gave one guy five talents and he turned it into 10. He gave a guy two talents and he turned it into 4. He gave a guy one and the guy hid it and didn't turn it into nothing. He didn't make nothing on it. And the Lord took away the talent that he had and gave it to the guy with 10. Did you not read these things in the Word of God? Brothers and sisters, that's what the whole thing that the Lord tells his church, you know, occupy till he comes. When his disciples said in Acts chapter 1, when the Lord was about to ascend into heaven, they said, when the man-child was caught up into heaven, Acts chapter 1, his disciples said, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom of Israel? And what did the Lord say? It's none of your business about those times and seasons. It's not for you to know, he said. But, you know, tarry at Jerusalem until you shall receive power from on high. Acts chapter 1, verse 8, you will receive the power of the Holy Ghost to come upon you to be a witness unto me. to in Jerusalem and into Judea and Samaria and all the uttermost parts of the earth. So our call from God, once you're saved, and I need to make another video about this, is to be baptized in the Holy Spirit with initial evidence of speaking in tongues, and then go be a witness for the Lord, operating in the gifts of the Spirit, as it says, signs and wonders following these signs shall follow those who believe. In my name, they'll cast out devils. In my name, they'll speak in new tongues. They'll lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. These things are supposed to follow those who believe. God is a living God and a dynamic God. You know the thing about it, brothers and sisters, I spent lots of time and patience, spoon feeding and baby feeding denominational Christians and not stomping on their toes about the fact that they don't believe that. They believe God's changed. They don't believe the Bible, and it says God, Jesus Christ, same yesterday, today, and forever, says the same thing about God, two or three different verses. One's in Hebrews, I believe the last verse of Hebrews chapter 12 or 13. And that God never changes, brothers and sisters. And in the church age which we are living in, those gifts of the Holy Spirit are still for us. And they come by those who have received power from on high. It's a whole separate thing from getting saved. And that's a whole other teaching. The disciples already got saved when they saw the risen Lord. And the Lord even breathed the Holy Spirit on them, John, the last chapter of John. Then they received this power from on high with evidence of speaking in tongues. That's when the gifts of the Spirit become operational. A further work of the Holy Spirit in the life of the believer. It's a whole other teaching. It's on website that we have there, Church of the Firstborn. The link is below this video in the Seymour area. You can go there and read the doctrine and discuss all these things, brothers and sisters, doctrinal stuff. The thing about so many, I praise God for people who can receive the things of God. The thing about people that have been trained in religion, like the Pharisees, they've been overly trained and not in the Word of God, but in a specific interpretation of the Word of God. They are following doctrines that other spiritually dead men have taught them. As it says, if the blind lead the blind, they both fall into a pit. Just like the Pharisees. You have one dead person, like the walking dead, leading and trying to keep everybody else dead and lead them into the pit. Our brothers and sisters, the Lord, His word is sharp and powerful and, quick and powerful and sharper than a two-edged sword, dividing asunder even the thoughts and intents of the heart, dividing, marrow from bone. Hebrews 4:12, always misquote that. I've said it, but I get it kind of mixed up. That's a hard one to remember. But brothers and sisters, hallelujah, you've got to be filled with the fullness of God, brothers and sisters. Today is the day to get your oil lamps filled up. Hallelujah. Go look at that. If you got all that head stuff going on, go read the doctrinal information. I laid it all out on the website there, going to look at a statement of faith, and I laid out, and then I even have a link there for about the Holy Spirit, baptism, Holy Spirit, explaining the whole thing, brothers and sisters. And people do resist because as Stephen told the Pharisees and the Sanhedrin there in Acts chapter 7, you stiff-necked and hard-hearted people, you always do resist the Spirit of God. And it goes on today in the church. We have the New Testament church is full of Pharisees, brothers and sisters, people that have lots of head knowledge, false converts. The majority of leaders in the church in all denominations, nearly all denominations, maybe not so in some of your spirit-filled denominations, but in all those denominations, they're not inspired by God. Inspired in the Bible, it means God breathed. God didn't breathe the sermons that they teach in there. They got their sermons from a book. They even get their sermons from online because they have no prayer life. The pastor of the church I went to, over 4,500 members, the secretary of the pastor was also an altar worker, and it was established by her and another witness. There's another way that the pastor of even that mega church, a spirit-filled Assemblies of God church, he got his sermons offline, brothers and sisters, but spent all week. Oh, I can't meet with anybody because I'm busy preparing for Sunday in case we have any, visitors to, that's the most important thing for him to do is Sunday morning service. That's it. Spent all week preparing, but he was getting his sermons offline. That's, I heard it by two witnesses many times. But anyway, brothers and sisters, the reason why that he had to get his sermons offline because he wasn't praying. He wasn't seeking God. He wasn't worshiping God. He was dead. He was dry. He was unrevived. And then all these denominational preachers are not only, they can't be revived because they were never revived. Revival is to be renewed from something that you had before. But lots of churches are led, all these old dead denominations are led by people that's never been alive. They just say they've learned a list of doctrines. You talk about the Catholic Church with their catechism. these old denominations, they have their thing. They don't, you know, they don't call it a catechism, but they call it like the Westminster Confessional. They confess to a list of doctrines and they go to school to study those doctrines. They don't study the Word of God as by itself. They study the Word of God through the writings of other men, brothers and sisters. Same thing, the same mistake that the Israelites made. Same things the Jews did. And when Jesus was talking to them, he said, you know, you nullify the Word of God by your traditions. It's the exact same thing all these denominations are doing. Brothers and sisters, we're not called to learn the doctrines of what men have written and the cunning fables of men. We've not been called to study what St. Augustine had to say. We haven't been called to see what St. Thomas of Aquinas said, to be an expert in what St. Thomas of Aquinas said or what, Dr. Regan said or Dr. Dwight Pentecost or whomever people want to say and keep quoting and worshiping these men. Brothers and sisters, we'd be called to become experts in the Word of God, that we would observe by the Spirit of God that God, it says, John tells us that, you know, the Bible spiritually discerned, and then God is the one, you know, as John says, you don't need nobody to teach you because the Spirit of God will enlighten you. But brothers and sisters, God had to put pastors in the church. You know why God put Ephesians 4:11, the reason why the Lord puts apostles and prophets and pastors and teachers and evangelists into the church is because it's so full of so many people that are spiritually dead. You know, the Bible spiritually discerned. You have to have someone to say no, 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 and point the way. Go back to the foundation. Go back to the Word. Go back to the Spirit and the Word. Go back to the book of Acts. Go back to Acts chapter 2 on the day of Pentecost. Go back there. Go back to the Gospels. Go back to the foundation of the Word. It's not all these things that you've made it. Hallelujah, Lord God. I'm coming back to the heart of worship because it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the things I've made it. But it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord. Tell him, I'm coming back to the heart of worship. Because it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. Brothers and sisters, I want to pray for you. Like I say, I always say this. You guys know it who are watching this. I can make a video about something the Lord showed me about the rapture. Thousands of people watch. Those fair weather disciples, those fair weather friends, those fair weather disciples will be on there high-fiving and telling all the things that they think about the rapture and the date of the rapture. But when it's time to grow and be discipled and to really get it in your heart and really get your oil lamp full, the thing that you need to truly be, you know, to really truly be born again. I'll say it another way. To truly be born again and truly be converted and truly be able to be rapture ready, they're not interested. That's what I say. You know, I need to make a video when the next time the Lord really gives me some serious information about the rapture. And the first thing I need to say, you know, is most people watching this video ain't going nowhere. Why are you obsessed about it? You are going to be the biggest fool that there ever was. You know, you spend all your time sitting around talking about the rapture, trying to calculate it, and then you're not even took the time to get your heart right. I should say that. Not it's get your heart right with God. Not your head, but your heart right with God. I need to title the video, get your heart right with God, not your head. I mean, they won't watch it. It's crazy. It is insane. I mean, you know, that as well as to be out here in Las Vegas gambling and partying and being a whoremonger, as the King James would say. You know, run wild. You're going to be here anyway. I don't think I would really say that, but you know what I'm saying? What futility of the silliness and the immaturity of people, brothers and sisters. It always strikes me, you know, it's not by might nor by power, but by my Spirit, saith the Lord. It's the Spirit of God of revival. That's what's wrong with America, brothers and sisters. So few people are really seriously with the Lord. Let's pray, brothers and sisters. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, hallelujah. Lord, we lift your name on high, hallelujah. Yes, Lord, you came from heaven to earth to show the way. From the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. Hallelujah. Brothers and sisters, I'm just, you know, the Lord is just leading me to say, sing that. And I pray God will bless you with all the fullness. The text I read, I pray that of you right now in Jesus' name. You know the depth and the length and the height of and the wisdom of the love of God, and to be filled with the fullness, all the fullness of God in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. May the Spirit of God get a hold of you. And the glory of God in Jesus' name. Oh, the glory of your presence. We your temple, give you reverence. So arise to your rest and be blessed by our praise, as your glory now fills this place. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. We love you, Lord, and we worship you in Jesus' name. I could worship and talk about the Lord all night, brothers and sisters, but I got to get finished packing up and get out of here. I'm going to try to make a mobile phone video while I'm in North Carolina. I'll be at the hotel. You know, there's no, I ask you guys to pray. You know, I'd never get words from people. I got a word from a dear sister, one of the sisters that I got. We were talking about that same text, but different points. As I mentioned at the beginning of this video, she had heard in her spirit from the Lord that God has a vehicle for us. You know, in the Philippines, our vehicle has died, and we need a new vehicle there for the orphanages. And so I ask you guys to continue to pray, and I'm in agreement with this sister. I believe she hears, I know she hears from the Lord that God has a vehicle for us. So praise God for that when we get to the Philippines. And for the orphanages. So I ask you guys to pray about all the needs of the orphans and the orphanages, all that stuff, brothers and sisters, and the needs of Joshua's ministry. We also need to, you know, Brother Clark has set up the website of the Church of the Firstborn, and we talked about moving it to Facebook, but I'm going to mirror it on Facebook. But Brother Clark is paying for all of the website. He's been doing that, and he set it up and everything, and I ask you guys to pray about it. You know, I know that God will make a way that we'll, you know, I don't know what all the costs are. He's got some different stuff on there. I don't know what all it adds up to. But I pray God will make a way. And then we have more traffic on there. You know, we have traffic, but there's no need to keep it, the website, if we don't have traffic. But if one person goes and reads the statement of faith and, you know, it means something to them, and they advance in their walk with the Lord by it, it's worth it, brothers and sisters. People share their dreams and visions on there on the Church of the Firstborn website. The link is below here. So I ask you guys to pray that God will send more people to the website that we can help them, and also people to sponsor the website. And I thank the Lord, Sister Karen, she's the moderator on there. If you put a prayer request or put a dream or a vision, well, the prayer requests go to Sister Karen. Actually, the dreams and the vision, I think visions, if someone puts it, still goes to Brother Clark. And then he CCs it to me. And for some reason, they don't come to me. Sometimes they do. I don't know what to deal with all that. But you know how these websites are, brothers and sisters. They're something else. But anyway, bless you guys all. And I thank anybody that's watching this video to this point. You know that I love you guys. I appreciate you guys. And I just praise the Lord. You know, God has taken this ministry somewhere. And it's to, of course, to the rapture. But before we get there, you know, it's just from glory to glory. You know, the Lord is just closer. I can, when I pray, the Lord is getting closer and closer to me. And I don't know if that's saying, you know, like for the rapture or both. Or it's also saying that, you know, I'm getting closer to being caught up to heaven and having some kind of visitation with the Lord, which is what I've been praying for the last 17 years. Not every time I pray, but I've been praying it consistently for 17 years. Or, of course, revival, of course, which are both. All of the above would be great. All of the above, brothers and sisters. That's my prayer, is to see the Lord. You know, I see the Lord seated on the throne. I want to see that with my own eyes. Exalted, and the trail of his robe fills the temple with glory, and the whole earth is filled, and the whole earth is filled with his glory. I want to see that with my own eyes, even before the rapture. Hallelujah. Praise God. You know, everybody's got something there that's in their heart's desire. That's mine, brothers and sisters. Hallelujah. Love you all. God bless. And I'm praying for those, everybody who's asked me to pray, anybody that I've talked to and emailed with, messaged, I'm praying for you. God bless you all, brothers and sisters.